A nice pile of mulch. A nice pile of mulch. So bad that I planted in honeyberries, and there's a few blackberries, hazelnuts, and I only did the front half of the bed. That's where I let them all in, and you can notice that there are seed heads from elephant garlic also growing. The last time I was here with the machine about a week ago, I cut wild raspberries out of here and then the canary grass. And I'll kind of work the weeds out of the honeyberry patch. Any roots in the ground is coming out, especially this little patch of canary grass here. I'll even chase the roots. You see, I did a little lawn mowing yesterday when I showed up. The final cut of the year, September 6th. Last year I cut it the first day of September. We're a few days later, and it worked out last year, but I think I can cut it later, and I'm experimenting. If it stays really green through gun season, that's the goal, through the firearm deer season. There are lots of different wild plants in here that the deer like to eat that also stay green because they were cut. Lots of forbs, and I've got different kinds of clovers, bird's foot, also growing in it. I threw rye seed in it before I cut, and I didn't have a lot, so not much. I had some leftover mustard that went in. It's not supposed to rain now, so it's probably not going to work out, but this is when I wanted to do it. That is a junction of three access roads. It's turning into a pretty nice little food plot. I notice all the bumps are smoothing out, not by force of the tractor, but by the roots and the stovers of the cuttings. Right here's a bare spot. Accumulates water. Little diversity, that's okay. A lot of plantain in here. I've seen deer eat plantain. Chicory is also in here. There I have a trail camera. I had a 6-point buck in here. Its rack matched the rack of the very first buck I shot on this property in 1998. This is a grove of sea berries split in half by the access road. And there are a lot of different other types of nuts, fruits, and berry trees growing in here. The sea berries are the nitrogen source. This tall spire tree in the foreground that had pears all the way to the top, but they're all stripped off, I'm sure from the coon this last week. This is a sea berry, sea buckthorn brush. Not only does it fix nitrogen, but it also provides a very healthy berry. The South Koreans figured out it has a compound in it that kills the COVID virus on contact. That's a service tree that I planted in the dense shade. And it's growing. Member of the rose family. I like this fruit for myself because you have to actually pick it when it's really hard and then bled it. And put it at room temperature on your counter or whatever, then it ripens. So the critters aren't going to be as interested in it. I think the coon got up onto this pear tree. It was leaning over severely, so I propped it back up with that stick. And there's pears on it, they're just not ripe. He probably got up there and tested them out. In so doing, he bent the tree over. These sea berries have never been this large, so they can change. And I've also noticed that they can ripen at different times, depending on the season. Those are very large ones. And sometimes they're very astringent, and this isn't too bad. There's hazelnuts on the inside of this grove, peach trees, crab apples, pears. That's a big cherry tree. That's a German cherry. Can grow like 60, 70 feet tall. And when it has cherries, it's going to be magnificent. The birds are going to be happy. There's also a couple lineup of hazelnuts in here, and I thought they were all dead, but they're coming up, growing up out of the canary grass. So you see that tree right there, center. Not the one in the sunlight. Let's see if I can get a right there. That is also the same German cherry tree, and I planted it at the same time. And it's maybe 10, 12 feet tall. And then this one is on the hugel culture with the sea berries. It's 20 feet. Lots of branching. From clay to hugel culture with sea berries is a huge difference. Another noteworthy observation is most of the trees that I planted on the north side, being shaded from the afternoon sun, made it. And I planted just as many, maybe more, on the south side. And a couple apple trees and the hazelnuts are the only thing. Oh, and a crab apple are the only varieties that made it. And it's also noteworthy that the apples are Antonovka, which grow a taproot. I put a lot of peach seedlings in here. None of them made it. Lots of them. I keep trying. There's got to be something, one of them growing in here, you'd think. We'll see over time. Look at that ash tree right there. That maybe well could be the oldest ash tree in the state of Michigan that's still alive. Here. On a permaculture setting, no less. I'll take a couple pictures and we'll share them to Permaculture Institute of North America. I've determined that there's a tree right here that I can sit on once or twice through the deer season for bow hunting, and it's right there. I want to be right in there. My head is going to be below that branch that comes out. There's a little window here that I can shoot through. Anything cruising up and down my food plot access road. I have a trail camera right here. It's at a curve in the access road. And there's a shack down there, right next to the pond. which grabs the thermals, sucks them down and away from here. Oh, and this is where I like to bait. I spilt my coffee. This was more wide open last year, and a storm came through and broke off all these balsam fir tops. So I dragged them to the edge of the access road, provide a little more side cover, and it'll hold the canary grass up. I'll let that grow. You see the edge is undulated. I've got some black locusts growing here. I'll probably cut those sooner or later and lay those into the road too. Leave just enough room where I can cut. See the different grasses. There's some rushes in here too. I don't think the deer eat the rushes, but I'm not going to spray them or anything. Just keep cutting them. They do provide some shade and cover for the hot summer months. Oh, I put some buckwheat in here too a couple weeks ago. Look at that. It's growing.
I forgot about that. I just hand cast it around. I had some extra stuff and I threw it in here.
It'll die at first frost, but deer can come and munch on it until then. Looks nice. Just glows. I think I just sprinkled some right in the center of the access road here. And I stopped. This year I don't really plant very much. There's some bird's foot growing in here. The little pocket right here. I have thrown seed into this little area. This part of the access road gets really wet when it rains a lot, or in the spring. You can see the divots from the truck coming through. I'm going to be doing some work here when I bring the backhoe back here. I'm going to build this up with rock and clay, just on the path of where the tires are, and then I want to build up the center with some topsoil. I got plenty of that here. This is an area I'm going to do some work on. It's got a corner coming up, and there's a corner back here, and I think the deer like that. They don't like to see a long way. It stresses them out. More movement, more wildlife, more other deer. There's some clovers growing in here. How about that? I started cutting the branches off of this white birch so I can make a saw log out of it. Of course, I won't live long enough to see that, but it'll be nicely groomed for whoever takes this over. I got quite a few of them that I'm doing that to. Quite a few is maybe like a dozen or something. I've got this honey locust growing, and eventually when the saw log is taken from the white birch, then the honey locust will take over. There's another type of locust in here, but that's like a swear word to some people, so I won't mention it. Here's another junction of three access roads. This is a little tighter, tougher situation where the water kind of pools up here, and it's very tight clay. So I'm going to work on this too, build it up. Do the same thing where the truck will come around, make a wide turn around and come this way. So the truck ruts will be clay and rock, and then the center will be more topsoil. Nice clover growing in here, how about that? I did throw a lot of red clover around here last year. I'm sure there's some hiding in this little brush here. This is a pile of clay and rock, so I don't even have to go too far to get it. Now I want to deepen this out so that it becomes a reservoir for the main pond, which is coming up. Look at all the rock I have. Lots of rock. And a nice clover growing in here. The deer haven't come in here and really worked on this yet, and that's good. When the leaves fall off the trees, then it's game on. And here in this part of Upper Michigan, it's coming. And then they'll be here. This is a little clay dome. That's material that come out of the pond to build upon. I seeded it with a couple different white clovers and 3-year red clover and chicory last spring. So this is its second summer it made it through. And the grasses were starting to take it over. But when I cut the grasses, look what appears. They start to grow. Now the first year it has its best protein nutrient content, and after that it starts to wane. But what I really want this to become is a area of hazelnuts, aronia, Nanking cherries, honeyberries, and some of the wild perennials like those cup plants. I actually kind of flattened out a couple spots, like right there and right over here. And there I'll keep that groomed, and I might even put some straw in there. And I think this is going to be bedding for deer when there's a north wind. That's when I want them to be here. That's the easiest way to hunt it, is on a north wind. But that's years from now. It's coming. And I might set up in this, there's a cedar tree in amongst those balsam firs, and I might set up right in there. Come down that access road on that side and just cut right in so I don't have any scent in here, and it's a little bit lower right there. Should pull my scent up. And a matter of fact, I want to build another little pond right there. And that'll be a pond that feeds the main one too. I'm 63, so I'm going to have to make it another 10 years. This is where I'm standing, it was kind of some topsoil on the top. Here, that's the clay that came out of the pond. And then I put some topsoil in as beds. And I planted rye seed in it, and not much of it really grew very well. I'm going to have to think of something else. There's the pond. Here I caged some of the clay that I planted the clovers and the chicory, and you can see how well it's growing in the cage. And then right outside the cage, the deer are grazing it. You can see there's more deleterious material on the ground there because it's been allowed to grow and die back. It hasn't had to go through a deer digestive system first. Which there's benefits to that too. So I made a little hitch in the road right here. There's actually a bed right in there where the weeds are, where I can come around with a vehicle. Semi-tractor and logging truck will be a problem. That thing can get something in there and widen it out that way if they wanted to somewhere in the future, but hopefully that doesn't happen. I'm going to do the same thing over here. I'm going to hitch it the other way. That there's not a straight line in here, only over the pond. The material from that pond came out, and this is total subsoil. And I'm rehabilitating the subsoil with clover, chicory, and I can see some other wild plants in here, including Queen Anne's lace, which is perfect because it'll produce compost corridors with its roots. And I had a cage here, that's why it's growing thicker, and there's a lot of material on the ground from past seasons where it died back. And now I moved the cage over to this spot. You see how bare it is right there? Yeah, we'll monitor that over the next couple of years. That'll be interesting. Junction of two ponds here. There's one on that side. There's one on this side. And there's a culvert 8 feet down. So they share the water. Last summer was very dry and it actually had water in it. That's after pailing maybe 100 pails of water out to water some small seedlings I put in the spring last year. And when it stopped raining, it was like, wow, I gotta water these seedlings. It's coming in really nice. I want this to all be cattails, the whole thing just dominated with cattails. Well, this side gets shaded too much. Probably not going to be many cattails. And I planted honey locust on this side, so hopefully the honey locust shades this. So no cattails means this is a reservoir of water for the pond with the cattails. Another trail camera right there. I'll pull that cart tomorrow when I leave. I also want to heap the center here with some muck. I did a little bit. I need to do some more. And the first time I cut this little spot, I grew a beautiful crop of mustard in it the first year. And the deer loved it. They didn't eat it for a long time, then all of a sudden one must have tried it and they mowed it to the ground. So then the next year I seeded it with the white, red, and chicory. White, red, clover, and chicory. And the goldenrod starts taking over. But now that I cut the goldenrod, I've had it stay green through a lot of frost. And the deer like eating it. I think it's one of the preferred parts of the greens in November if I can keep them green. I was afraid I was going to hit the blade with a rock when I got in here, but it worked out okay. I thought there was a rock hiding in here, so I didn't cut this spot. You can see the chicory's growing pretty nice in it too. I've cut canary grass. I've been experimenting with cutting it, and it stays green if it's cut. I had a batch stay green and when I cut it in August, and then the next couple of years I cut it in August, it got kind of old looking come firearm season, November 15th. So now I've cut it September 6th, and it's going to shoot up green. I just shot up green last year when I cut it September 1st. And the deer will eat it. Alkaloids and all. So I put some of this pond material here. Create separation between the food plot here and the one behind me on the clay dome. This has got a lot of sawgrass in it. There's a few palatable species in with it. I'm not spraying, so it's going to grow. The trick is to find what the deer like to eat that'll grow with it, and maybe sooner or later dominate it. Bird's foot will grow with it. The deer don't really graze that down like crazy until really late. They pick at it. So here's a little pocket food plot. This whole field would be like this if I didn't cut it. You see the edges? But because I cut it, the bird's foot's growing very well. And I have an annual rye that I seeded. It has small seeds, and I seen stalks of it with seeds on it, so all that got reseeded. And that actually happened when I cut it 4 weeks ago. There's a pre-cut and now the real cut. The pre-cut tamed it a little bit, and then the real cut now was easy. I actually had to go over it twice with the pre-cut. I had to lift the front wheels of the push lawnmower to get the cut done. And then I went over it again. And now a third time yesterday. This actually had a covering of hugelkultur material. When I was stupid, I had a bulldozer come in here and scrape all the stumps off. And they piled them all up here down to my right. And the whole thing rotted into soil. There wasn't a single piece of wood looking material in it. And when that excavator was here, I had him track it up here. So this has got it. There's a strip here, and then there's a strip up above that's got that material. So in the end, I'm going to refashion the whole strip into a food plot so it'll double the size. This is it right here, the rest of it that's got it. But there's some big rocks that are sticking up, and I can't really lawnmow it. There's some big divots. So when I bring the backhoe up, I'll scrape it, get the big rocks out of it, even it out a little bit so I can get the lawnmower over it. We'll be good to go. I grew a Three Sisters crop in here last year. That's why I got the cage. And then I planted Swiss stone pine seeds in here, but none of them came up. And then the milk cluster came up and use it as an opportunity to grow. Okay, got it. There's some of that small seeded rye, you can see it. Drooping its seeds all over. This is a vernal pool that I dug. There's some fingers in it for more longer edge. And if it was just a circle here and you measured that circle, that's all the edge you have. But when I built these fingers into it, there's more edge. And edge is where the most life is. This year is the first year in a long time that it didn't totally dry up. There's just a little bit of water left in the bottom. It's important that it, if not totally dry, it gets close to being dry, because then it kills the minnows. And it's a good place then for the salamanders to lay their eggs. Otherwise the minnows would eat the eggs. There's two minnows that come in on duck's feet that I know for sure that are already here, is northern dace and sticklebacks. So nothing up there is groomed for deer. That little cage area has mostly hazelnuts in it, but I've got a couple Swiss stone pines in there and some barely hanging on plums and crab apples. Nice little stand of hazelnuts there that's occurring. Those are the ones in the cage are Americans, and these are hybridized between Americans and Europeans. The ones in the background are hybridized ones, and you can see the ones in the front, those are Americans. Leaves are turning color. When the excavator was here, I had him dig this ditch. It's otherwise known as a swale on contour. And what it is this is all clay, and when it rained, the clay just ran off of it. Nothing soaked in. So now the water gets interrupted from its flow and it sits in this swale. And it soaks in or becomes an incubator for salamanders if it holds water enough. And as it, you know, this thing is full in the spring from spring melt, and then that water along the edge of the swale mound, this is where the material went. It came out of here and went over there. The mound soaks it up. You know, the better soil went there, the topsoil went there. We actually dug the whatever topsoil was off first and put it to the side, and then dug the clay out and then put the topsoil back over the top. This was totally bare when we dug it, and we dug it in 2013. So it's taken this long for even some plants to grow in it. Now I like these reeds. I want these reeds to grow in it. That's great side cover. And the water will stick in here just a little longer. Reduce evaporation. Right there is a hugel culture of white ash. And I planted, I don't know, when I first planted it, I might have had 50 trees on it. I mean, it was crazy. I had tubes all over. But, well, maybe not 50, but maybe 25 anyway. And, you know, most things die here. The clay is just too tight. And on this hugel culture, more than normal lived. We got apples and crab apples and mulberries, aronia, hazelnuts, all growing on it. Some in the foreground here, I had planted lots of things in there, and most of them died in the middle. I don't know why, but on the edge they stayed. Here's a really nice looking hazelnut coming out of the canary grass, and canary grass actually gives way to goldenrod. You can see that's occurring right here right now. And then the goldenrod give way to the wild raspberries. And that's like 10 or 12 years or 15 years or something. So that apple tree had apples on it last year, just a couple. Actually, I'll grab one of them, put them on a table. Maybe no raping on a table, I can see what it tastes like anyway. I want to plant a couple of Swiss stone pines on it, but nobody's selling seedlings. I keep looking, and I bought a bunch of seeds last year and none of them sprouted, so I have to try harder. And this is one of those swear word trees. Yeah, look at that. Sending suckers over here where nothing, hardly anything will grow. Once they get done with it, all kinds of stuff will want to grow. So here you see this was thick with canary grass, and now the goldenrod's coming in. This is a rectangle of that hugel culture soil as well. That's okay, let this do the work. This is the very first swale that was dug on this property. Very little catchment. But every spring it's full of water. It's growing. Things are growing. That is an oak tree growing that I planted from an acorn in the year 2000. That is a little bitty seedling that I planted, I don't know, 6-7 years ago, called a nutty oak. Supposedly it's a hybrid between a burr and a white oak. The one that I planted as an acorn year 2000, I'm pretty sure that's a burr oak. I should probably get a video of the tree that I took it from. I knew it was going to send up a spurt of growth this year. These hazelnuts here weren't caged. The deer were allowed to graze them. And understand this. Right here, these are hazelnuts, right there, right there. Understand this, the ones that I caged and the deer didn't graze, some of them are even smaller. So I'm going to be removing this cage, but I just didn't have the time this year, maybe next year. There's some Swiss stone pines in there. See, the clovers are growing pretty good in there, so I guess that's a reason. Not quite the end of the tour, that we're going to be doubling back. Well, this is a little pond that has the fingers as well, and when you look at it from above, from like Google Earth, it looks like dinosaur prints. But when the excavator dug this out, we compacted the soil on the downhill side of it, and it definitely holds the water. Better than the one either below or above it. You see, there's even some lily pads growing in there. So, you know, we didn't create a dam or anything. All we did is we took the biggest rocks out and then put the clay back, and then he pounded it with his shovel. I planted a whole bunch of red osier dogwood sticks in here, and a few of them are still alive. Growing pretty nice. The deer just grazed the heck out of them, so somehow they have to avoid the deer. I don't even see any on this stretch. I had a whole line of them here. Great deer food. Get them established. This is another little hugel culture area. This is a series of swales and swale mounds made out of the hugel culture. I've got a lot of crab apples planted on it. A couple plum trees. I added some cherries a couple years ago. This one's going to form apples this year, but I don't see any on it. I guess if there's blossom, that doesn't mean much. Still need a bumblebee to come in and work it. planted a few honey locusts here on this large hula culture. And they're not doing great, but they're still alive. One here looks pretty nice. That's got some new growth on it. Another one over here looks okay. Gotta watch my feet. Yeah, that one's doing okay. That's highlighted in the skyline area. Yeah, lots of new growth up there. Good. Right on the end of this hula culture. I'm thinking that big maple tree will die, but I'm hoping it doesn't. If it does, these locusts will take it over, the shading part of it. And that one there is dying. You disturb the roots from digging the ponds, and that's what happens. Or could happen. This is a tamarack right here. I like tamaracks. Had a trail camera on that little tripod there for a couple years, but then the goldenrod starts swaying in the wind and triggers it. Had to move it. This little area here with the brushy appearance, that was my experiment with hazelnuts and cup plants. It's peach seedlings in here. This is a Corsicusa. It's a cherry tree. There's a Aronia in here somewhere. A service tree. I don't see anything in this cage, whatever was in it. Oh, there's a hazelnut growing on way on the end of it. This is a service tree. I think it's working out. This is a peach tree. These deer really like the brush trees. Now I'm thinking I'm going to take this cage here off of here and put it around that peach. Let the deer eat that. They'll disturb all these chicories. Reseed itself. See if I can move it right now. Do it. Yeah, it's a good idea. Good enough idea. If it's a good enough idea, I should just do it. All this talk. Too much talk and not enough action. Yeah. That's an interesting experiment. Let's see how the deer respond to that. I don't know if they'll eat the asters that are really nice and fresh here. Some brand new goldenrod coming up. They'll probably munch on that. Clover's in there. Good. You can see the trees coming up over the top of the goldenrod. Most of those were planted in 2015, 2018. Last year I added a lot of hazelnut seedlings. There are also a few Korean nut pines in here. There's one right here in the corner. At least there used to be. Oh, there it is. Let's knock down some of this stuff here. That is a Korean nut pine right there. There's five or six of them that are alive in here yet. Just to the stage now that they should start to shoot up above everything. Oh, look at that big Neanderthal berry right there. I'll take that, eat that for dessert after breakfast, put it in my pocket for now. Maybe I should save that one and try to grow the seeds. Some more aronias that aren't ripe yet. Look at this. This was bare just a couple years ago. And here is a service berry. Another aronia. Oh, that's got big berries. Jeez. How can they have such big berries back here? Oh, this one is loaded too. I'm gonna have to come back here and harvest these. I gotta bring a bag or something. Okay, those are big berries. And you see, you got the first, it was canary grass. Now the goldenrod, and they actually have a little chemical that they put in the soil that suppresses the canary grass, and then the wild raspberries don't care, and then they'll take over the goldenrod. And those are the easiest to pull out of all. When you get a stand of wild raspberries, you can just put a pair of gloves on and yank them out. More big berries here. Jeez, I can't believe how big these berries are. No, these aronias like it here. Keep growing. They're getting to the point now where the deer will graze them too. Deer really like aronia berry leaves. I planted a lot of red osier dogwood in here. I'm sure I cross over a bunch of them. Lots of them are still alive. Got some comfrey growing in here. The deer really like eating the comfrey when it wilts away a little bit. That's actually a source of iodine, rare source of iodine. You got a little patch of carnelian cherries. Here's one right here in this cage. Another one here to my right. Two of them here to my right. It's all the way to the top of the cage and all. There's another one right here. That is a carnelian cherry. I planted as a really teeny seedling, like an inch tall. I've had to really take care of it. I think there's a five of them growing on this complex. Whatever I was protecting here looks like it's dead. Couldn't make it. That's normally what happens here. They just die. Just die. A couple of pines in here somewhere. Right there's one of them. Now that the hot summer sun is over, take some of the shade off of them. Especially in the morning sun. I like morning sun. That's what we have right now. A little, this is a cedar growing on it. Here it is right here. That's kind of too much for him, I think. No, they probably had an association. I'm going to kill it. There's the other pine. Oh, that's a really big size. Oh, that's a big. Also, cedar's growing right. That is a Korean nut pine. It really likes it to be here. Korean nut pines and the Swiss stone pines, they like this clay. I won't pull a cedar out, I'll just break them down. There's lots of it growing on this lawn complex, so it's okay. Yes, grow. You can do it. Boy, it looks nice. That was a little teeny thing when I planted it too. Even smaller than that. Those are very expensive nuts. Now we're coming into hazelnut territory. We'll see if any of them made it. Ah, there's some right here. And one right there, it's got lots of leaves on it. Get that morning sun in here. Give it a month of good sunlight in the morning. I think it'll grow another couple inches yet this year. And next year, Katie barred a door. Yeah, that looks nice. There's one growing out here too. It's a separate one. That might be from a sucker. Right next door. That looks like an apple. This is a nannyberry in here. I don't. Oh, it's there, but it's not. It's not doing too well. Doesn't look good at all. Right here. Those are kind of newer leaves from this year, I think. Might not like the, it was grazed in the center. How did anything get in there? Maybe it really is affected by the poison of the goldenrod. I get some morning sun right here. Another cage, so there's gotta be hazelnut in here. Yeah, look at that. It's coming. Some of the vetch growing in here. I like vetch. It's a really nice ground cover that fixes nitrogen. Yeah, now we got some morning sunlight in there. Another one. So these were just plants that sprung up in my backyard from the squirrels planting them. And I'm thinking they're hybridized because I've got Europeans and Americans. But that has a leaf color of an American. This is an apple tree that I had to cage because the voles were just mercilessly coppicing it every single year for years. I caged it a hardware cloth. Well, I should probably put a cage around the top of it because the deer are going to be eating on it. I might have caged a poplar tree here. There's a red bud in here growing. I should take the cage from this one and put it on that apple tree right now. Because soon I'm not going to want to walk back here at all because I want the deer to be here. And if I'm here with my scent, they're not going to be here. There's enough coffee here for a drink or two yet? Oh yeah, look at that. Along with whatever drops in there. And the honey locust there that the top died back. I planted it as a this large of a tree. And it's alive. Grew a lot of new branches here on the bottom. That looks like an apricot. This is definitely a crab apple because look, it's got some crab apples on it. Lots of them. Hopefully they start falling off right before firearm season starts. I already cut down the brush a little bit around this hazelnut. And it doesn't have a cage. There's a sister one. These two were planted a couple years ago, a year before the rest of these little seedlings. That is a persimmons, I think. And right below that persimmons is a hazelnut. Couple mulberries are still alive. Oh, that's a Chinese chestnut, or no, that might be a chestnut leaf oak. I did plant some Chinese chestnuts in here too. Coldstream Farm seedlings. I mentioned that for the plant Nazis. Oh, look at our wasps are still alive. Ooh, I'm waking them up. They don't like it. Okay, I'm moving along. I tried grafting this mulberry a few times. But I saw some catkins on it this spring, so it's, I think it's a male. Here's the sun side of that crabapple tree. I'd like there to be 50 hazelnuts on here. Here is a Korean nut pine. Looks really nice. A couple of them on this little mound. I got a cage here. I think this is a malt hash. I planted 25 of them. There aren't very many alive. I'd like to have 20 of those growing on this complex. I'll plant some more next spring. What's in this cage? Oh, this is a chestnut leaf oak right here. I'm pretty certain of that. There was like a maple growing in here too, some type of a maple. I don't even know what that is. Doesn't really have a maple leaf. Kind of does, but who knows who's growing in there with it, so what the heck? Let's find out. I don't see anything in here. I'm pretty sure this was also a mountain ash in here, and I don't see anything. Right here, this is it. Oh, there's a bud on it, look at it. So maybe it just lost its leaves. There was a European mountain ash too, so maybe that's a European. There's another chestnut leaf oak. I'm hoping that they drop their acorns later, closer to firearm season. Yeah, there's a mountain ash in there, it's just barely hanging on, look at that. Get it some morning sunlight. Okay, that's all you're going to get for now. And with that large leaf thing, that kind of looks like a persimmons too. I planted a lot of those in here. I don't hardly any of them grow. That is an apple tree. Got grazed for like 3-4 years in a row by the deer, and I put that cage around it and it just shot right up. This was around this honey locust. It's put on really nice new growth. See, I cut some branches off of that. White birch, make a log out of it. Long time from now. Some guy who claimed to work for the DNR years ago, he come and traded me some willows for a bunch of stuff. And he got the way better to trade. There's one of his willows. All these special names he had to him. I planted a whole bunch along this little swale here. This is one of them. And another one. He probably laughed at me all the way home. What a dumb idiot. I just dug those willows out of the ditch. and he worked for the DNR. He said he worked for the DNR, so I thought he was special, but his wife was looking at me really suspiciously. So I think they were con artists. There's a black tupelo in here, but it's gone. Planted 100 does too, and I don't think there's even one alive. The Chinese chestnut growing in that cage. You can see it growing there. A little lighter leaf color. This is another plant that the deer are grazing heavily every year. And it persisted. While most of its mates are dead, it was still alive. There was like one leaf left on it when I put that cage around it a couple of years ago. One thing about this land, it's tough. And the trees that are growing here better be tough, too. You got a highbush cranberry and an aronia in here, but the aronia isn't doing so good. Highbushes, looking pert. Now this is kind of a deer thoroughfare here, and they do graze this hazelnut heavily. This is a precocious that came right from Okois. I once put a pickup truck of compost right where all this really thick goldenrod growth is. Now the raspberries are coming in. I'm going to plant something there, I just don't know what yet. Let it go through its cycle. Oh, look, a deer bedded right here. Right on the thoroughfare. So around this little misshapen or well-shaped pond with a lot of edge here, I have aronia and corsicusa growing in here. And there was one other thing that I planted on. But I'm going to dig them all up because they're just languishing here. I'm going to put them up by the honeyberry beds. Right here. I see a kusa in there. And I don't know if that's an aronia. There was one other plant I put with them. And it mostly died out. That's probably why I can't remember it. I have 1, 2, 3 cages left, and the whole thing was surrounded with them. There's an elderberry here that might make it. I think that's an aronia there and there in that cage. Mulberry even had some berries this year. There's another aronia over there. These all leave. See hazelnuts growing over there. In that cage, these hazelnuts. Boy, these languished for a long time. Now some of them are popping up. There's 25 of them in this area. These are ones that came out of Restoration Ag. Oh, what's this farm called? Forget. But this is just all tough clay here. It was bare. Totally bare here when I planted them. Here's one I think cage is coming. That is a hybrid right there. An Okois. Version. It's got catkins on it, so maybe next year we'll do something. Thought it had some nuts on it. Yeah, right there, yeah. First year grew nuts. Better. I'm going to plant them today. There's a few more in here. I'll leave those on. I'm just going to cover my bed here, get a couple of them. I like it, they're ripe and they're totally brown. So this little American is having catkins too, look at that. So the American below. I don't see any of that. Oh, there's nuts on this one. Oh, look at that. They're a lot smaller than Americans. Oh yeah, there's catkins. Catkins below. Oh, lots of them. We'll leave that on there. Maybe it'll ripen some more. Catkins below. And catkins above. Lots of them. Oh, there's a peach left on this tree. Looks like it's ripe because there's holes in it. Everything wants to eat it. I want the pet. Well, maybe I picked it too early because it's pretty tight. Well, we'll find out. See where the deer were grazing on this. Catkins, more catkins. We might have a bumper crop of hazelnuts next year. There's no gray squirrels around. That's why the nuts can ripen on the vine, on the branch. Supposed to be a peach in here somewhere. Oh, here it is. Growing out of the cage. Get that peach leaf curl. I've been just cutting them down when they're older. If they get curl so bad that the peaches fall off that are forming, I just cut them down. There's a spray, copper spray you can use. I don't want to use a copper spray. I would like to develop some peaches that don't need copper spray. I planted quite a few peach trees around here. They can't handle canary grass as well as the hazelnuts. Oh, there's one in here growing, right here. And here it is. This one. Two is over on that side. Yeah, there, right there. Not as robust. I think there's some type of plum right here. It's doing very well. Bunch of tubes. There's got to be 500 tubes on the property laying around. That's how much planting I did in the beginning. Well, I had a lot of vigor in the early stages of this. Here's another lineup of aronia that aren't doing that well. You can see the cages. I think there's four of them. I'm digging them up, bringing them up to the honeyberry patch. There's a really nice Corsicusa. There's like four or five of them that are growing. Not quite this vigorously, but they're doing pretty good too. This is a service berry. A grove of black locusts with black walnuts thriving under the protection of their roots and thorny branches, nitrogen fixation. I'm walking along a swale mound of the circle swale, and I planted black walnuts on it on this side. There's some other species growing, interplanted with it. More tests than anything. I sea berries migrating over here, provide nitrogen, thorny protection. There's Drusen artichokes planted all over the place, and they're growing wild now. There's a white salsify growing here that went to seed. I got some of those seeds up at camp to plant. I don't see any other ones here. There was some more, but I know the goldfinch like eating them. That's a Chinese chestnut. That's the center of the circle soil in there, and there's lots of hazelnuts planted in there that are doing well. Locust trees, cedars coming up in there, I'm letting them grow. Put a couple of horse chestnut seedlings in there this year. Red bud, plum and crab apple. This side here I planted a lot of trees, and man, they barely live a month and they die. I like to put some pine in there because the pine do well where nothing else wants to grow. Korean nut pine or Swiss stone pine. And we're back. The junction of three access roads, food plot. That's where we started the adventure, hour and a half ago. There's the trail camera, record our entrance and now our exit. Time to get some more coffee, think about doing something constructive. I decided to mulch the cardboard. See the cardboard under here? Thick layer of mulch over the top, and that it lasts through the winter in the spring. If there's any left, I can reuse it somewhere else. And this honeyberry here really likes to grow here. Then I discovered at home that blackberries, thornless blackberries, like to grow in with the honeyberries. So I'm establishing that type of a planting. But I made it all the way to the end, but I ran out of mulch. But back here is the layer or the establishment of the wild raspberries, which muted everything else, and they'll be easy to pluck out. Now, all along here now is going to be Nanking cherries. Maybe I'll put a Cornelian cherry or two in it at the north side, the shade side. Maybe I should do a couple of them to protect from the late afternoon sun. And I spent some time getting all the tape off the cardboard. Otherwise, I'm picking plastic out of here for years. And then I learned that the plastic doesn't degrade, it just breaks up into little bitty tiny pieces, micro pieces, microscopic pieces. I'm sure there's a bacteria or fungus or something that'll eat them eventually, but who knows? The issue is we don't know. So, cleaning it up as good as possible, which I don't think there's any on any of the cardboard anymore. That looked over good too. I'll bring some more cardboard next time, finish this. And I do have, there's some mulch right in here that from the raspberries I cut. Can layer that over the top. Good enough for now. This is a complex of five beds. I'm going to reclaim them all. Different kind of an acorn that the swamp white oak wants to make. Kind of pretty solid. Huh. Installed this cage because I planted radish seed in here. wasabi radish. You see all the dimples? Each one represents a seed. I'm hoping I grow 5 nice radishes in here. And I also just sprinkled some parsnip seed right over the top. I'm gonna take some of this edge material that I dug this trench out with and put it right over the top of the seed, and then I'll water it. And the rest of it will be pushed up right here. I can do this right now, just push it right up. You know, something comes and digs right here, they'll encroach a cage. You're gonna have to really dig to get to it, to the bottom. So, that's that. It's just the grass. Asparagus right here, we want to leave that growing. Here's another one. Alright, so I'm going to sprinkle the inside of that, cover up the seed and water it, and another completed project. I want fall radish. This is September 7th. It's been hot, and that's the reason why I'm waiting to plant fall radish. We're going to have another hot spell next week, and that'll help to germinate them. And if it stays hot, then I'll just put some more hardware cloth on the sun side to cast more shade into this area. There's the bunny friend. Where is he? They camouflage so well. Oh, there he is. Hi. I'm coming over there to inspect my garden bed, you know. I could tell he was upset. I caged this off and there's a carrot and some salsify in there. And last night he came over there and he's looking in there. The rutabaga and beet patch, along with a few peas you can see to the left. I harvested a beet yesterday and ate it, and thinned out the rutabagas and ate those too. All I'm looking for is a few big roots. I'll take another one next time and another one the time after. It'll be a nice line of big ones. We're going to have some monster kohlrabi. Celeriac on each side. I had a very good happenstance yesterday, or this morning actually, where yesterday I clipped off one of these seed heads, and these are seeds that are still in the milk stage, fennel seeds. And I put some in my pot that I normally make hot water for coffee, and I made a tea. After coming in from trudging in the swamp most of the afternoon, I was tired and I wanted to relax, and I thought, well, this is the way to go. What a fortunate happenstance, because this morning I made coffee and I left those seeds in the pot, and one of the seeds made it through the strainer and I was able to eat it. How glorious. So now I'm going to clip a whole bunch of these off, and I'm going to bring them home, and I'm going to boil them a little bit, then I'm going to fry them in butter, see what happens. I definitely have enough. I had eggshells from eating eggs in the morning here. Sprinkle that over the top. A slow leach of calcium and all the other elements of an eggshell. Update on the parsnip. Look at the rabbits and the deer don't eat parsnip leaves, but humans can. Isn't that amazing? If those leaves are any indication, there's going to be a monster root here. The winter rye is on its way. That's another one that I like, eating the seeds in the milk stage. I ferment them and then fry them in butter. What a glorious flavor. I planted the smaller cornelian cherry pits right there. There's also some radish seeds in here. These fava beans, I don't know why I want to call them lupine, but lupinis. But these fava beans are tall. Not a problem for the radish, but the first frost, these fava beans are over. We just made it through a little cold period. Now there's a week of hot weather coming. So they'll like it. This is a summer squash. It's one of the Native American ones. It might make a squash before the frost come. Well, it is making a squash. What am I talking about? I planted this from seed really late. I had a lot of problems this year getting up here. Spring and early summer. I dug out some really nice potatoes out of there. I'll have to display the potatoes because they're wonderful. Through some artichokes, I'm sure there's a big mound of them in underneath these stalks. A skirret. I grow big fat skirret roots up here. I tied it all up here so it's not overhanging the path. And of course, the amaranth. And finally, the showcase of the garden beds. I grew Sudan grass in this bed last year. And the year before that, I formed it up by flipping a compost pile back and forth to mute the grasses. And then that compost was what made the bed up. And then I grew that Sudan grass. Then this spring, I put all the contents of the ferment tank on it in this area here where the peas and the beans are growing the best. And part of the ferment contents, well, most of it is wild plants, but part of it was a deer stomach. And all I got to say is, wow. There's also potatoes growing in here. I can see one right there. Some type of a squash or something is growing right there. I didn't plant that one. Potatoes I planted. This is just wow. Just wow. And I planted this very late because of all these problems I had. And these beans, I think, are going to make her. That's what I'm worried about the most, though. Early frost. But we have a lot of beans formed. And now with this week of hot weather, you know, and hopefully there's 3-4 weeks of hot weather left, or warm weather, I'm going to have all kinds of beans. Peas can take a couple frosts, not a problem. So we're going to definitely get peas. Look at it. They want to go. And I planted the peas and the beans together. Now last year I planted the peas first, and 3 weeks later I planted the beans. So that the beans wouldn't overwhelm the peas. Because these are climbing beans and they will wrap everything. And because I planted them together, I trained the beans to get on the shade side of the bed and climb up this deer fence. And if any want to keep growing, they can eventually work to these sticks that I got installed. I think I need another one right here. Now what I need to do is unwrap it, send it to that pole that's already there. You can see there's a rogue tomato. I didn't plant that tomato. It's growing right there. It's growing up through them. Of course, you know, tomatoes are vine too. And I see blossoms, but I don't see any tomatoes down in there. I have to figure out a way to look in there. Guess I can get my arm right in through here and grab them. There's another potato that's finding sunlight. I think there's a beetle that's sucking the juice out of the stems of these leaves that are wilted. Oh, this is just amazing. Well, there's one other thing to check on quick. All the rest of the beds are empty. I don't know what I'm going to do. So there's a series of five beds here that circle, and I had the excavator form them up before I left, and this was 10 years ago now. It was like 2015. And well, when I start to retire, I can reclaim them. The work is done, you know, the big work is done. No, reclaiming is the issue. So last year I planted little tiny honeyberries into this bed here where you can see it's worked up. Now I'm reclaiming the rest of the bed. I have cardboard underneath the mulch that the logs are holding down. You can barely see the cardboard through right here. There's a better example right over here. You can see the cardboard right here. So I want to smother the weeds, and the canary grass is the worst of it. But now there's also wild raspberries. Those are actually kind of easy to pull out, but this will soften it all up. Next spring when I get in there with my little pick, I'll be able to pull all the roots. But again, the honeyberries, you can see that's a really nice plant. There's a nice plant. A majority of them made it. I didn't weed it until probably July. And it was succumbing to all the weeds. When I pulled the weeds off, well, then they all took off. Like right here, we're missing one. So there's a dead one from there. Probably missing one right in here, or maybe in the background. Then when I came over here with the mower over the top of it, I cut that one. So now it's sprouting new leaves. One missing here, and that's the last one. Aurora and Berry Blue. Then there's thornless blackberries in here and hazelnuts. Once these bushes get up, then they'll suppress all the weeds. They'll shade them out. All I have to do is do maintenance on the paths. Then next year, the next bed. You can see the next bed. I like it that the wild raspberries get in there, and they actually succumb. The wild raspberries actually take out the canary grass. There's just some starting to come in there. But this is all canary grass here, and now it's all wild raspberries. They grew up over the top of them. They got the thorny canes. You can see there's still some canary grass hanging in there. But by and large, it's gone. And if the humans ever want to harvest the berries, they're going to have to cage it. Which I'm not going to do, probably. I'm going to cage a little patch of this of similar planting up by the camp, up by the cabin, on the north side of it. But this I'm not going to cage. I will let the birds have them. Just get it established. You know, I'll get a few, I'm sure. If I outbury them. I did a tour yesterday of the entire area that I cut the grass to provide fresh pick for the deer into November. I guess that's what we think looks nice. I got honey berries established in this pile of weeds. I'm going to be going through that this year, this fall, or maybe in the spring. And I'm going to transplant some of them because they're really close together. They're starting to grow pretty good. But this is on the north side, or on the east side of the cabin. I want to have honey berries step down into that ditch. And then this old cage. You see the honey berries coming out right there. There's three pretty large ones right there next to one another. And then I did a mound layer and separated some. You can see them coming up here. I think there's like five of them in here. So that'll be honey berries into here. And there'll be honey berries in the next one. And then all the way down to that apple tree. Then I'll probably do a cattle panel caging system with chicken wire on it. I don't know for sure what I'm going to do, but that's the plan, man. Even the most ardent chemical spraying fascist will have to admit this looks good without sprays. I'm keeping close eye on RFK Jr. because he's an attorney litigating these chemical companies. Now that he's made a deal with Trump, and I expect Trump to win the next election because the other one is illegitimate, was never voted in to be, you know, a presidential contender. So I think Trump is pretty much a shoo-in. You know, I guess there's things can happen. Somebody could kill him, right? But if RFKJ has an appointment in that administration of Trump, we are going to get to the bottom of these chemical companies and what they're doing to the land. They're speeding up entropy. And that doesn't end well. Having planted a lot of pawpaw seeds on these fingers going into the pond. Finger and a finger. I keep coming to look to see if there's any coming up. And I don't find any. And then finally look. I see one. I planted these 2 years ago. Holy cow. Pretty sure that's pawpaw right there. It sure would be nice to have pawpaw established on this side of the pond. This is the sun side. That casts a lot of shade. And keep this water cooler. Slow down evaporation. Thought I planted a bunch in here too, but now that I'm looking, I think I see another one. Right there. How about that? Excellent. Maybe there's a few more in here yet too. I got a nanny berry in there. See the cage right there. Planted a couple of honey locusts on this side, but I think they're both dead. I planted them late last year. Didn't really get a chance. Oh, there's one that's alive right here. Here we go. Oh, yeah, there's a tag down there yet. So it died back. Right here's the top. And then it came up again. There's another one over here somewhere. Now, there's a cedar growing there, and I really don't want any coniferous trees growing because I want the sunlight to come in here in the winter. Oh, here's the other
tag here. Here's the tree. I think that one is dead.
My $16 pond lily is still alive. Grows a pink flower. I might have to cut back those cattails there. Get at the flower.
Look at Grandma's spring onions. I'm making a go of it in this clay subsoil. I'll be darned.
Can you tell? I moved that cage. That's going to be a nice amount of chicory seed here that's going to throw down itself on the ground. I won't have to do anything. This honey locust is actually making a nice living here. Nice new growth. I noticed it and I started knocking down some of these ferns. There was a grapevine growing in here. Now it's going to get a lot more of that morning sunlight. It's got another month it can grow yet, maybe longer. This is a very light brown toad. I might be the one that's on the watch list.
Not surprising. Permaculture design implementation for wildlife will attract everything. And if we can help to propagate the species that are in decline, reverse the situation, we're in good stead. Go that way. Go that way. It's kind of clearer that way. I don't know if there's anything. There you go. Keep going. There you go. There you go. Nice to get a chance to see you. He's saying goodbye to me. Look at that. Yep. I'm heading for home, so you're on your own now.